So yesterday we were looking at various non-idealities that are presented by the master ancestor, and today we'll just go forward, see a couple more of those, right, and then move on to other aspects of the behavior of a master ancestor, and you know, what are the things that we need to keep in mind as circuit designers. All right, so the last topic that we were looking at yesterday was the problem of sub-threshold conduction. This is essentially a IDS that flows from drain to source. Right? So from the drain to the source, even when the gate to source voltage VGS is less than the threshold, so in other words it is not strong enough for the channel to form, but because of the fact that there is a gate to source voltage, some increase in the number of electrons is there at that interface, and that shows up as an increased current. Okay, that increases exponentially until such time as the channel is formed, after which the equations that govern the flow of current switch over to the on mode, so the linear mode or saturation mode, depending on what the VDS is. Okay, so effectively the important factor over here was the subthreshold slope, right, which is measured in millivolts per decade and essentially tells us that for so many millivolts change in the VGS as it drops below threshold, there will be a 10 times reduction in the drain to source current. So obviously the smaller the value of the subthreshold slope, right, expressed in millivolts per decade, the better it is, because a smaller value of delta VGS will result in a 10x reduction in current. Okay. In practice, this works out to somewhere between 60 to 90 millivolts, at least for the older technologies. It depends on technology, it depends on various parameters that are influenced by how you manufacture the transistor. Okay. Alright, so one additional aspect that influences the subthreshold current is something called the drain-induced barrier lowering. Okay. Usually referred to as the Dybbol effect, right? DIBM. Okay. What this means is something like this. When you apply a positive potential at the drain terminal, so this is where your depletion region, because of the drain to bulk junction, it's a PN junction, so there is a depletion region associated with that. This dashed line essentially shows where it is under zero bias conditions. Okay. And what we are saying is, as the bias on the drain increases, as the drain voltage increases, this gets pushed outwards. Okay, so that it finally becomes something like this. I'm exaggerating the effect over here. How much it actually moves is governed by some equations that are reasonably well known. So it is possible to sort of predict how much that junction is going to increase or decrease as a result of application of voltage at the drain. Right. The important point is that junction, there we can call it the location of the junction or the depletion region, not the junction, the depletion region, that location sort of changes with application of this drain voltage. Okay. Effectively what that means is you are changing the channel length also. Right. Not the channel length is being affected, okay, that comes into the channel length modulation, but apart from that also comes that this much part of the channel is in some sense slightly easier to invert. There is an additional effect. The drain is also helping to invert that part of the channel. Okay. The net effect of something like this is that the threshold voltage, the VGS which is required in order to invert the channel, reduces. Okay. So hence the name, right? The drain has induced a lowering of the barrier. Okay, because of the drain voltage, there is a reduction in the threshold voltage, a reduction in the gate voltage required to invert the channel. Hence we call it drain induced barrier lowering. Okay, now what that means is that the drain induced barrier lowering also has a secondary effect on the current itself, on the subthreshold current, right? It means that effectively you have changed your VT, the threshold voltage, and therefore the ease with which subthreshold current will flow has also increased. So dibble has multiple effects. I mean, subthreshold conduction is one of them, but overall also it has an effect in terms of reducing the threshold voltage. Okay, all right. So this part of it I'm just leaving qualitatively. I'm not going to go into any of the numbers over here, right? Similarly for the next couple of things that we look at. So the next non-ideality is something called junction leakage. And this is fairly easy to understand. Effectively what we have is drain to bulk and source to bulk are reverse biased PN junctions, right? And there will be some reverse bias current flowing through them, right? That's basically called the junction leakage. Okay, so this is once again just an aspect of the physical construction of the MOSFET. The very fact that there are two junctions over there means that to some extent there will be flow of current in the reverse direction. Okay, now typically as we go to more and more advanced technologies, the observation has been that the subthreshold conduction is usually much higher or something to be more concerned about than the junction leakage. So in most cases we are more worried about subthreshold conduction than junction leakage. Many of the aspects that affect one also affect the other. So I mean, for example, the area of the drain and so on, you know, some things of that sort can have an effect on the total current. So the junction leakage is usually considered a second order problem nowadays. Okay, the next thing is something called gate tunneling, right? Now what happens over here, effectively what we are saying is, from our construction of the MOSFET, we have assumed that we have an insulating layer and a metal on top of that, and that is what constitutes the gate, right? So the gate is essentially silicon substrate, p-type substrate, insulating layer and metal on top of that. Okay, the insulating layer we assume is a proper insulating layer, meaning that the current from gate to bulk should be zero. Okay, but now think about the thickness of that gate, right? Already at 180 nanometer technology, the thickness that we were associating with the gate was on the order of 4 nanometers, right? As we advance in technology, we want that to scale even further. We want it to go even further down, but that becomes increasingly harder because you are actually getting to the point of atomic sizes at this stage, right? So the scaling, the reduction in thickness of the TOX, the thickness of the oxide, is not proportionate to the reduction in the length and width of the transistor. Having said that, there is some amount of reduction, okay? Which means that we are now ended up in a situation where the gates are so thin, it is possible for quantum tunneling effects to come into the picture, and for some amount of current to actually flow through that insulating barrier, okay? So this is straight tunneling through the gate insulation, right? Simply because it is TOX is very small, meaning that it is small enough that the tunneling effects become significant. Okay, now obviously this is another one of those features, just like subthreshold and so on, various other, a lot of these parameters, the reason why we are mentioning them and sort of making a big deal about them is, as you go to smaller and smaller technologies, those effects only get more and more pronounced. Okay? In previous technologies, in older technologies, there used to be other kinds of problems such as CMOS latch-up and so on, which are still there, but we know ways around them. So CMOS latch-up, for example, typically by using different wells while constructing the MOS transistors, we are able to avoid that kind of a problem to a large extent. Right? Certain other features were simply not an issue. So the short channel effects and all were not much of an issue when we were talking about 350 nanometer or 0.5 micron processes and so on. Right? But as we go to smaller and smaller dimensions, some of these other issues, right, subthreshold conductor, subthreshold leakage, gate tunneling, right, these are big problems and are becoming more and more serious because there is no way that they are going to go away. Right? The direction in which you are moving is such that these are only going to get more prominent. Okay? Already at 180 nanometers, even if you just run a SPICE simulation, you will find that the current which is flowing through the gate is non-trivial. Okay? I mean, compared to the on current of a MOS transistor, it's several orders of magnitude below. But in the off state, so for example, when VGS is zero, or not zero, in zero, of course, no current will flow through the gate. But when VGS is small, there is no on current through the transistor, you will find that there is some amount of gate tunneling, which can get to be significant depending on the various conditions that you are working on. Okay? Alright, one last thing to, once again, just qualitatively I am going to mention, it's important to keep this in mind. What is the temperature dependence of these various parameters in general on the behavior of the MOSFET? Okay. So it turns out that the temperature at which the chip is can have effects, can affect various different parts of the MOSFET behavior, right? One of them is that in general the carrier mobility, what do you expect will happen over here? What is that mobility? It is essentially the constant of proportionality which relates the electric field to the velocity of the particles, the electrons or holes, right? So why did we say that there was this mobility parameter which was this constant of proportionality? What we said was, when you apply an electric field, the electrons or holes try to accelerate, but they bump into the nearby particles, hence slow down. Overall, they settle into one constant average velocity. That proportionality constant is your mobility. When temperature increases, what do you expect will happen? The sort of random movement of all the surrounding particles is going to increase, right? More energy in those particles, more likely that you will bump into something. So at least at a first order intuitive level, you can sort of imagine that the most likely result is that the mobility is going to decrease. Okay, and that's in fact what happens. Carrier mobility decreases. Okay. Now, there is another effect which is the subthreshold leakage, which is in turn because of the fact that the threshold voltage itself decreases. Why does the threshold voltage decrease? Because of various other physical parameters, it's observed to decrease with increase in voltage. Okay. When VT decreases, the most prominent effect, right, the one thing that hits you first, is the fact that the subthreshold leakage increases. Okay, the gate tunneling also increases to some extent, but that's not to do with VT. It is a effect of the increase in temperature itself. Right. So overall, what happens is that the on current of the transistor, right, because of this reduction in carrier mobility and so on, decreases with increasing temperature. Okay. Now, as we will see later, what happens is the on current of a transistor is the primary determining factor in how quickly the gate that you are constructing, whether it's an inverter, NAND gate, whatever it is, how quickly it's able to switch, how quickly it's able to make its output rise from 0 to VDD or drop from VDD to 0. Okay. So if I reduce this on current, what it means is that that's going to take longer. Okay. And therefore your circuit can no longer work at the speed at which you expected it to work. Okay. What that means is at higher temperatures, the maximum speed at which your circuit can operate will drop. Okay. Now, there used to be a big fad about 10-15 years ago, I don't know if it's still there now, where people would talk about overcooling processors. Right? So those who are interested in building their own computers, right, you can essentially go out, buy an Intel processor, buy a motherboard, put the entire thing together and get it working. Right? So there was some amount of excitement in building your own system and, you know, getting it working. You're just assembling parts, but still, you know, you can pick and choose the way that you like. Okay? Now, people who are doing that would also say, okay, now I want to run this at an even higher speed than what the system is rated. So you buy a processor that says it can run at 2 gigahertz. You would like to run it at 3. Why? If it runs at a faster speed, that presumably means that your overall system is going to work faster. Okay? How do you do that? You make sure that you are able to cool the system much more effectively than whatever was the natural cooling that the system provided. Okay? Right now, if you go and open any one of the desktop machines that you have, or even a laptop probably, desktops especially, you will find that there is a huge copper heat sink sitting on top of the processor. Okay? At least the good motherboards will have good copper heat sinks, the others will probably have aluminium and some, you know, slightly cheaper way of doing it. They will also have fans, some way of dissipating heat as quickly as possible. Right? The next step is to say, look, even air cooling is not good enough, I actually need to have liquid cooling. I put water. But obviously, I can't just pour water on this, so I have water circulating over there by means of some pipes. Right? The end goal is just this. Why are we doing all of this? Because there is a strong temperature dependence on the performance of the circuit. Right? When you are hitting speeds of 2 gigahertz, 3 gigahertz, and so on, every extra bit of heat that you can pull away means that your circuit can work slightly at a slightly higher speed. The higher the speed it's running at, the more power it is dissipating, and therefore the more heat it is generating. But if you are able to pull that heat away fast enough, you can keep the temperature down, and therefore your circuit can run at a higher speed. Okay? So this is sort of a very important effect in terms of the overall speed at which especially high performance circuits can work. Okay? If your circuit is only working at 100 megahertz or so, then you probably don't need to worry about this effect too much. Right? By the time it gets to the point where this affects your operating speed, you have probably hit other bottlenecks in terms of how fast your circuit can operate. Okay. Alright, so that concludes our discussion of the various non-idealities associated with transistors. What we are going to move on to next is two of the additional parameters that we are interested in as far as a MOSFET is concerned in the operational regime. Okay? We already looked at the ID versus VGS and VDS characteristics. Right? Those are what are called the static characteristics. I keep VGS constant, vary VDS, plot ID. Keep VDS constant, vary VGS, plot ID. Right? Do some combination of both, end up with a large number of curves. It helps me to characterize my transistor, right? So I understand exactly what it's doing. But we are interested in another mode of operation of the transistor, which is called a dynamic mode, right? What do you mean by dynamic? It means that voltages and currents are actually changing rapidly with time. Okay? In particular, there are two aspects of the transistor that we need to worry about. One is, what are the capacitances associated with a transistor? And what is the on resistance, or how much resistance does a transistor offer when it is in a so-called on mode, when it's behaving like a switch that has been turned on. Okay, so those are the next two things that we are going to look at. Right? So the first is the capacitance. So what we are saying is, this is a symbol of the transistor, gate, drain, source. Right? There are a couple of things that we are interested in. as BG changes, right? The VG, at least it's sort of easy to see why there is a capacitance. There is a conducting metal, there is an insulator, and at least for sufficient values of VG, there is a conducting channel underneath it. Okay? So in some sense, it's sort of obvious to see why there is a capacitance associated with this, right? It's not a resistance because there is an insulator, so you don't really have a direct flow of current. But the capacitance, we can imagine, would be much more influential in terms of determining the impedance of this particular terminal. Okay, so we are interested in what happens, how much sort of charge accumulation or discharge occurs as a result of any change in the change at the VG terminal or the G terminal. Okay, so that's the first thing that we are going to consider. After that, we'll also consider what happens if VD or VS vary. Okay, we'll consider each of these separately and sort of try and understand them, and why we need to sort of build a capacitive model of the transistor. Okay, alright, so VG, what happens over here, right? The first thing is, we can think in terms of effectively two aspects of this, or rather, you know, there are many different ways of looking at the capacitance of the gate. Okay. Initially, when your VG is small or it is even negative, what happens is that there is actually some kind of a direct capacitance between the gate and the bulb. Okay. Now it turns out, I can't really prove this out here, but at least one way of thinking about it is, for, you know, even negative values of VG, right? What happens is, at some point when you have negative values of VG, you are going to get some accumulation of holes. Right? The p-type substrate is already there. You have put a negative value of VG, it's going to attract even more holes to that interface, to the point where sufficient amount of conduction takes place that it almost looks similar to what the channel would be, right? Except that now there are holes over there instead of electrons. There is no inversion, there is no sort of abruptly turning on of the system. It's a gradual accumulation of holes over there, right? Which essentially means that the capacitance, if I look at it, what is the capacitance? It's saying that I've got some gate voltage, some bulk voltage, some source and drain voltages. Under that bias condition, I now incrementally change the gate voltage, and I want to see how much is the delta Q as a result of that delta V. Okay, that is how I am going to define my capacitance, right? Now, when you have that accumulation region, effectively what happens over there is, you get an effective capacitance which is something in the region of W into L into C aux, right? The area of the gate, W into L, multiplied by C aux, which is epsilon aux by T aux. Why is there epsilon aux by T aux there? Because effectively this is a parallel plate capacitor from the gate to the accumulated holes that are there, right? Now typically this is only going to be there for negative values of VG. Okay, so perhaps this is not really the best way to draw this figure. It would be more accurate to sort of draw it like this, right? But what happens after a while is, as VG increases, you find that that effective capacitance sort of starts dropping away. Why? Because there are no longer sufficient accumulation of holes to form a conducting layer over there. You don't really have a gate to channel or bulk capacitance, right? So that capacitance starts dropping away with time. But what happens after a while, when you hit VT, when VGS becomes equal to VT, channel forms, and very quickly this capacitance goes back to WLCX, the same value. okay. Now this is actually observed. You can in fact run a simulation which will show you that this is in fact how the variability of the, you know, the dependence of the capacitance on the gate to source voltage varies. Okay. This is interesting. One of the things it's telling you is, even though that gate to bulk was an insulating layer, it's not a constant capacitance. It is voltage dependent. Actually, it depends on the value of the gate to source voltage. Right? Now, how are we going to use this transistor? We are finally going to be using it as part of some digital circuit, where presumably there will be some large scale switching of voltages across it. Right? In digital circuits, we are primarily only interested in voltage equal to 0 or VDD. Right? We are not really interested in the intermediate values. So what that means is, I am switching from 0 to VDD. Right? So the VGS, the gate voltage at some terminal, is very likely to change from 0 all the way to VDD very quickly. During that time, that gate capacitance, whatever capacitance is seen at that terminal, is actually going to vary. Right? Now, a time varying or a voltage varying capacitance is not a very nice thing for us. It makes our analysis and general understanding of the system extremely difficult. Okay? So what we do instead is to sort of just approximate it and say, look, for practical purposes, I will just consider the sort of average value of the capacitance, or even just consider the capacitance under the high voltage conditions, one of those corners, which is the more common operating scenario. Okay? So effectively what we do is, we end up taking this value WLCOX as the effective gate capacitance. Okay? So in other words, when I have this kind of a structure, you know, a MOSFET being used, and I am applying some gate voltage at it, the effective capacitance is primarily determined by what parameters. COX is a technology constant. W and L are the parameters related to the design of the transistor. So they are determined by the circuit design. Okay? Larger the transistor, W and L are larger, the more capacitance. Okay? Now, in addition to this, there is also something called an overlap area over here. Okay, these parts marked in blue are essentially the overlap areas. Right? And effectively what happens over there is, you directly have a parallel plate capacitor effect. Right? You have a conducting gate, a conducting source or drain, because they are N plus type, and in between an insulating layer. Right? To top it off, the electric fields themselves are not just going to go directly vertically downwards, there will be some fringing effects associated with them, which means that definitely they will sort of go through this overlap region. Okay? So net effect is that there will be some amount of extra capacitance which is determined by the extent of overlap. Now that extent of overlap has nothing to do with the L of the transistor, but is related to the W, or the width of the transistor. Okay? So if we sort of put everything together, effectively what we have is that the CG, the gate capacitance, is going to be given by W into L into COX, right? Where COX is basically epsilon OX by TOX, plus W into C overlap drain to gate, plus W into C overlap source to gate. Right? Drain to gate and source to gate are most likely going to be almost the same values. Right? They might be slightly different because there are different bias potentials at the source and drain. But apart from that, they are going to be very similar in terms of the values. The electric fields might be slightly different. That's all. Okay? So effectively, one thing that we can see over here, in other words, is I can sort of think in terms of, you know, divide out the entire thing by W, and I get CG by W is some parameter LCOX plus C overlap BG plus C overlap SG. Right? L, the length of the channel, most likely is going to be kept at a constant minimum value, the smallest possible length that I can get away with. So effectively, this entire parameter can be sort of pre-computed and kept as one technology constant. Okay, which means that when I go around and create transistors, right, assuming that I am sticking to the minimum length possible, which is usually the case in digital designs, but I will be varying W quite a lot. Okay, under those conditions, all that I need to know is take the value of W, multiply by the C per micron, the per micron gate capacitance, and I get the overall actual value of the capacitance. Okay, so this per micron value of capacitance is sort of an interesting number. Okay, let's see if we can calculate it or estimate it and see what, how it is going to behave as we go through different technology nodes. Okay, so first thing I'm going to do is ignore the overlap capacitances. I'll add those in as parameters later, right? The important part, in other words, is C aux. This is equal to epsilon aux by T aux. Okay, which means that this is approximately given by this value, 10 to the minus 12 farads per meter, divided by 4 into 10 to the minus 9 meters. Okay, which means that I am going to multiply by L also over here. L into C aux in this case, in our case, is going to be given by 180 nanometers. Okay, so we go ahead and sort of cancel terms approximately, we replace this by 10, right? I'm just making some approximations over here. The important point is I finally end up with this thing which tells me I can write this approximately as, this is 1500 into 10 to the power of minus 12 farads per meter. I would like to express it in units that are more sort of understandable for me. So I'm going to write it in femtofarads per micron. Okay, just a scaling factor, right? So 10 to the minus 15 farads is 1 femtofarad, 10 to the minus 6 meters is 1 micron. So if I rewrite this, I will essentially end up with 1.5, approximate, I made a number of big approximations over here, but 1.5 femtofarads per micron. Okay, now the interesting thing is, if you look back at the 250 nanometer process, 0.25 micron, you would find that this would be 215 to 10 to the minus 9, this would be around 6 into 10 to the minus 9. So both the length of the transistor as well as the thickness of the oxide have gone up, and have gone up by pretty much the same factor. That was intentional, that is related to the problem of scaling which we will look at later. Okay. You go back one more generation, 350 nanometers, also true. You go down one generation, 130 nanometers, also true. Both of them scale somewhat similarly. As we get even further down, so we get to sort of 45 nanometers, 32 nanometers and so on, this oxide doesn't scale the same way, right? So then this relationship sort of breaks down. But what you can see is, otherwise, for several generations at least, this L into C aux was pretty much a constant. So this 1.5 femtofarads per micron is pretty much a nice approximate value that you can take as a constant. Okay. In particular, what we usually do is C gate we also take the overlap capacitance values into account, and we say approximately 2 femtofarads per micron. Per micron of what? What are you multiplying by? What is the, you know, the dimension that you are multiplying by? Dimension of length. What is the value? It is W. Okay. So this gate 2 femtofarads per micron has to be multiplied by the W in order to get the actual gate capacitance. Okay. So around 2 femtofarads per micron is a good approximation that we will be using for a number of other computations as we go further. Okay, at least for the hand calculations. For the assignments and spice simulations, the numbers will be given to you, what number you are supposed to use. For hand calculations in class, we will just use this number. Okay. So what that means is, for a minimum size transistor, where your W is going to be how much? How much will the W be for a minimum size transistor? 360 nanometers, right? Remember what I discussed the other day? Typically what we have for a minimum size transistor is L equal to 180, that is 2 lambda, but W is 4 lambda, 360. That's just a convention. There's no sort of fundamental physical reason why that should be. It is more a question of convenience of design. Okay. But anyway, with W equal to 360 nanometer, this means that the gate capacitance of a minimum size transistor would be around 0.72 femtofarads. Okay. So just a number to keep in mind. Why am I going on stressing on these numbers? Because it's a good idea for you to get a feel for those numbers. As you go through and you are working out problems, you should be able to sort of look at numbers and straight away say, are these in the right ballpark or not? Right? Am I at least in the correct area as far as doing the computations is concerned? I should not suddenly be ending up with a gate capacitance which is 20 femtofarads. That seems wrong. Right? Or something which is like few picofarads. Definitely wrong. An individual transistor with a capacitance of few picofarads is very, very unlikely to exist in a design. On the other hand, you may end up with picofarad capacitances due to some external loads. That's a different story. Okay. Alright. So this is the gate capacitance per micron. What next? What other capacitances could possibly exist in terms of what we are interested in? Looking back at this figure, like we said, we are interested in the drain and source. What happens as I vary the voltages in the drain and the source? Okay. Now, to understand that, we need to sort of take a closer look at what the drain and the source look like. So far, I have just sort of drawn a cutaway section over here where I concentrate on the gate area. So the drain and source are just shown as two N plus regions. Right? But in practice, those N plus regions have a certain physical extent. And most importantly, they form reverse biased PN junctions. Okay? So the drain, for example, is one reverse biased PN plus junction. The source is another reverse biased PN plus junction. What happens when I have a PN junction under reverse bias? That has a certain capacitance associated with it. It's usually called the diffusion capacitance or the depletion capacitance. Right? It's a capacitance corresponding to the depletion zone. Okay. Right? So if I look more carefully at it, I will concentrate on just the drain region now. Going into the surface over here, what I have is this is the gate. This is a sort of three-dimensional view of what the drain region looks like. Source looks identical. Okay. There is of course some kind of a metal contact and so on top of this. Fine, leave that aside. The important part is that the capacitance essentially corresponds to this region. Right? Where this is somewhere in the middle of this diffusion. Right? The N plus diffusion. Okay? So, if we look at this, we can once again sort of define a capacitance, right, which is proportional to the area of the drain region. Right? So, what are the parameters now that I need to be concerned about? what is this value over here that I have marked in red? The width of the transistor. That is the width of the transistor, right? This is the first time we are sort of looking at it in three dimensions, but that is the width of the transistor. So far we were only looking at the length, which is the distance between source and drain. W sort of goes into the picture in all the diagrams we have drawn so far. I'm drawing it from a slightly different viewpoint, therefore we end up with the width coming up over here. Okay. What about this dimension from here to here? How much will that be? What do you think? I mean, have we looked at that before at all so far? That's something we have never been concerned with so far, right? Because we have always assumed that the drain and source are n plus regions, and therefore left to themselves they are just sources of electrons, right? We don't really care about how big they are. They need to provide us with the electrons that need to go into the channel and therefore sustain a current whenever required. Okay? But in practice, when you are actually drawing this out, it turns out that they actually occupy space. The drain and source diffusions have to occupy a certain area, right? And that area is pretty significant. Okay? As you will see when we finally go to doing the layouts of transistors. Okay? So this anyway is usually termed another parameter, sometimes called LD or LS, right? Which is essentially the drain length or the source length. Usually LD is equal to LS in most cases, right? We don't necessarily see any different reason to differentiate between them. Note that this is different from the sort of L drawn versus L effective. There also we use the term LD. So just be clear that over here when I write LD, I'm talking about the length of the drain region. Okay, so what does that mean? Effectively what it means is that the C depletion is equal to, or rather the C drain is equal to C depletion drain to bulk per area, per unit area, multiplied by W into LD. Okay, but if you look closely at this, right, that LD is only what we sort of see underneath over here, right? I'm going to just hatch that out in dark green. It is just this section, right? There are actually other areas, surfaces that are in contact with the bulk. One of them is this sidewall. The other is this sidewall. And finally, we have this side. Okay? So the blue and magenta marked regions over here are the so-called sidewalls of the drain to bulk diffusion region. Okay? Why do they happen? Because you are performing the diffusion from above, the n plus region is going into the silicon substrate to some depth. Depending on how much that depth is, some side walls form, which are the interface between the drain region and the bulk. Okay? So rather than worrying about the exact, you know, area of the side wall, one thing that we know is, after all, this diffusion was being done by above and is a process control parameter. So this height that we have over here, h, right, how deep is that diffusion, is also a process control parameter. So rather than worrying about the area of cross section of these junctions, I can take the capacitance per unit area, multiply it by this h. And then all that I need to do is multiply by the L or the W, as the case may be. Okay? So what we have is, there is a C sidewall. Okay? and this is per unit length. In other words, H is already included in this. Okay. So what do I need to multiply it by in order to get this thing? I have a C junction sidewall which is per unit length. I need to multiply it by this LD over here, another LD over here, and this W over here. This other terminal over here does not have the C sidewall. Why is that? Because the channel is present over there. So the behavior of that is not the same as a P-type substrate. Okay? There is some kind of a drain to channel capacitance over there, but typically that is much smaller, so we sort of ignore that channel. At least to a first order. What is more important is we need to take the other three sidewalls because they are clearly N plus to P junctions. Okay? So the overall capacitance is given by this value. C sidewall into what are the lengths that we need to consider? 2 times LD plus W. Okay? So effectively what happens in other words is that we are going to consider that the drain capacitance is equal to some C junction bottom multiplied by the area of the drain region plus C junction sidewall multiplied by the perimeter of the drain region, where the perimeter is defined as length, width, length, and leave out the last segment. Okay. It turns out that when we are actually doing a spice simulation of this, we take this AD and PD as actual parameters to be given to the transistor in order to model the fact that it has some area corresponding to the drain and source, and therefore you need to take those capacitances into account. If you don't specify these, then by default it just assumes zero, and therefore you get a zero drain and source capacitance, which is not realistic. Okay. Source capacitance exactly the same. It's the same mechanism, so pretty much the same value over there also. Right? Now, once again, for a given process and for given values of LD and so on, it's possible to factor out that W. So that your drain capacitance also becomes something proportional, you know, some capacitance per unit length, which can be multiplied by W to get the overall capacitance to a first order approximation. Right? Now, this is, as far as this capacitance is concerned, it's actually a number of different approximations we are making here. Even though I wrote down that, you know, the depletion region has a capacitance associated with it, from your device modeling course, you would know that that capacitance is voltage dependent. It depends on the bias across that junction, which means that as the drain voltage changes, that capacitance changes. Okay? If that is the case, then essentially what we have is we have to take some kind of an average capacitance across the different possible ranges of voltage that are present over there and take that as the value that we deal with. Okay? So what we do is put all of that together. Simplify, simplify, simplify. We need only something which we can use for hand calculations. What do we say? We finally say that CS and CD is also given by this number, 2 femtofarads per micron of gate width. Where did we get this 2 femtofarads? It turns out that if you plug in all the numbers and do the calculations, this is a close enough approximation. Okay. Now that number, the fact that the gate capacitance per unit gate width and the drain or source capacitance per unit gate width turn out to be the same, is an interesting coincidence. It need not be, right? If it's not the same, then fine. If we introduce some extra parameter into our computations. But it turns out that if we make this assumption, it makes some of our analysis and discussion a bit easier as we go forward. Okay? It is not at all crucial. It doesn't need to be equal. But it makes our calculations and at least our explanations a little bit easier if we assume this number as we go forward. So for this class, at least I will assume that these numbers are equal. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now. Tomorrow we'll look at resistance and the scaling parameters.